Right, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to this, the 27th meeting in 2015 of the Economy, Energy and Tourism Committee. Can I welcome our witnesses, who I'll come to in a second, welcome members and welcome guests in the public gallery, and can I remind everyone please to turn off or at least turn to silent all mobile phones and other electronic devices so they don't interfere with the sound equipment. Item one on the agenda, can I ask if members are content that we take item three in private?
Yep, agreed.
Thank you. Can I also ask members if they're content that we take consideration of our draft report on work, wages and wellbeing in private at future meetings?
Agreed.
Great. Thank you. That is agreed. Item two on the agenda, we are continuing our inquiry into work, wages and wellbeing in the Scottish labour market. And today we have our final evidence session. I'd like to welcome from the Scottish Government, Roseanna Cunningham, who is Cabinet Secretary for Fair Work, Skills and Training, who's joined today by Joe Griffin, Director, Fair Work, and James Boyce, Labour Market Statistician, Employability and Skills Analytical Services, all in the Scottish Government. So welcome to you all. Before we get into questions, Minister, do you want to say something by way of an introduction?
Yes, just for a couple of minutes. If I can say, first of all, thanks very much for the invitation to contribute to this inquiry. The link between work wages and wellbeing is pretty much at the heart of my portfolio as Cabinet Secretary for Fair Work, Skills and Training. And the government is trying to lead the way in the encouragement of a culture of fair work in Scotland because, and this is pretty important, because we believe it makes sense both economically and socially. And it's critical to the inclusive growth agenda that was set out in our economic strategy. When the First Minister published the economic strategy, she articulated her view and the view of the government that a fair and socially just society needs a strong, successful economy. And the strategy shows that boosting competitiveness and tackling inequalities are not mutually exclusive, but are fundamentally linked. If we want our economy to deliver more better paid jobs for all, then to achieve this, we need that inclusive and sustainable growth. And inclusive growth is going to be driven by innovation, obviously, increased productivity, and the relationship between employers and their employees should be at the heart of this. As you've heard, I think, during the course of your inquiry, fair wages, decent conditions and good quality jobs do have a positive impact on people's physical and mental health, as well as making the whole of the country fairer. We have many employers, I think, who are actively embracing these challenges and reaping the benefits. There are now, I think, 380 accredited living wage employers, because it does go up quite fast. It may now be slightly more than that. Mackie's has just had their accreditation publicised today. So it is a figure that keeps moving. And over 125 employers who've signed the Scottish Business Pledge, which is related to this agenda. So we are making great progress. And we will continue to build on that. And just as a backdrop, of the 380 accredited living wage employers in Scotland, the UK figure is about 2,000, so we are punching well above our weight in terms of that accreditation stats. An important aspect of the work that is being done is the setting up and the continued operation of the Fair Work Convention, which we have set up to work independently from us. It was established earlier this year. I think you've heard evidence from the co-chairs in regard to that. It was established to bring employers and trade unions together around the table to develop a blueprint for what fair work should look like in Scotland, and that will be completed by March 2016. That's the timescale to which they're working in this initial phase. So, I mean, obviously I can't second guess what they may recommend, but it's pretty critical that employers and employees are jointly leading the debate about this. And once that blueprint's produced, we'll work closely with them to implement any recommendations. Our overarching aim, though, is to promote a new type of dialogue between government, employers, employees and trade unions. And that's, in our view, a very different approach to the one being taken at Westminster. So we'll continue to use what levers we have to oppose bad employment practices, such as exploitative zero-hours contracts and the use of inappropriate umbrella companies. The procurement guidance on fair work practices was just published on the 8th of October, and that makes the position very clear. It sets out how, as a government, we will consider a whole range of progressive workplace practices, such as a living wage and workplace equality, when awarding government contracts. Now, while the powers that are potentially coming to Scotland through the Scotland Bill are limited, we will use them to their full potential to support this agenda. For example, we've said we will abolish fees for employment tribunals. I'm only too aware of the health impacts of bad work. I've outlined some key things we're doing to make workplaces fairer, and I think we would probably, around this table, all agree that it would benefit the whole of Scotland if we could continue to raise the bar for as many people as possible. Thanks very much.
Okay, thank you, Minister, for that introductory statement. We'll now move on to questions. I think we're going to cover quite a range of the topics you've already mentioned in your statement. And we're going to raise a number of issues that have been reflected in the evidence that we've taken. Can I remind all members if they would keep their questions as short and to the point as possible, and answers that are as short and to the point would be helpful. And Minister, feel free at your discretion to bring in your officials as and when you feel is appropriate. I wonder if I could just start off on the question of wages, which has been quite an important focus of the inquiry. We've taken quite a lot of evidence around the UK government's new national living wage coming in from April, and the living wage. And I think everybody who's given us evidence would understand that the ambition for all businesses to pay the living wage is something that's widely supported. We've also heard in evidence for some people in business around some of the challenges they face in paying the living wage. We did have a session with people from the care sector who said their ambition would be to pay the living wage, but because the amount of money they have is constrained by the money they receive from local authorities, that makes it very difficult for them to do that. Can I maybe ask you to say a bit, Minister, about what more can the government do through the tools that are available to it to promote the living wage? What mechanisms might you have to assist private businesses who want to pay the living wage but are currently struggling to do that?
Right, well, the last part of your question would lead us into a discussion of subjects like wage subsidies, etc., which I don't know whether or not that's where you would want to go. In terms of the impact of the living wage and the national living wage, I just want to be kind of clear, because the terminology can confuse people with this new, what I've been calling enhanced minimum wage introduction as of next year, rather than calling it a national living wage, because I think there's a danger that people begin to get very confused about what it actually means. I think I need to say at the outset that any increase in wages, whatever it is going to be welcome to everybody who is in receipt of that increase in wages. So I think we need to be just saying that absolutely at the outset. The move towards the national living wage for next year, therefore, is welcome for those people who will obviously get increases out of it. I rather wish the Chancellor had chosen a different terminology. I suspect I understand politically why he chose the terminology he did, because we need to be clear that whatever rate that is set at, and I think it's 720 from April next year, it does not constitute a living wage, which is now newly set at 825 an hour. I do understand, however, that there are challenges, particularly in some key sectors, for paying this. And those challenges don't go away just by changing terminology. So we've got to think in terms of how business indeed can be supported in that. Given, however, the backdrop of there being less money all round, a discussion that would lead us into things like wage subsidies, which is inevitably where some of that would go, would be a difficult one to have, and one that we'd have to explore extremely carefully. There are examples of companies in all of these very challenged sectors who are currently paying the living wage, and the work that we've been doing to encourage companies to step forward and accredit, although we acknowledge there are companies that may be paying the living wage that aren't actually stepping up to accreditation, is so that there are good examples in as many sectors of the economy as there possibly can be. And there's quite a list of companies, for example, in the care sector, who are currently paying the living wage, the true living wage. And they're examples of how it can be done. So what I would hope to encourage is a conversation more widely, particularly in the most challenged sectors, as to how it is that some companies are able to do this and others can't. And that's a big conversation around business models, which we can be part of, but I don't think we can absolutely dictate. And we certainly can't dictate with the powers that we currently have.
Interesting answer, but where are we with that conversation? I mean, is this already happening, or is it something you aspire to?
Well, no. Yeah. I mean, I'm already having these conversations. Yeah. I mean, we, in fact, some of the conversations have been going on for quite a while. And you know, the purpose of our continued focus on the living wage and fair work is to generate that conversation, not just a two-way conversation between government and business, but also to generate a conversation between business and business. Those businesses that have taken this step and will tell you how beneficial it's been. I want to try and get a situation that develops where those businesses can talk to the others who aren't so keen or believe that there are barriers. And I do hear about barriers. I hear a lot about barriers. And then maybe an institution or a company in that same sector will pop up as accredited living wage employer. So then the issue then becomes, well, how have they overcome those barriers? And if they can overcome those barriers, then others can as well. So that, in a sense, is a conversation that is ongoing, both in a formal and an informal way, and will also be part of the Fair Work Convention work.
Maybe I can just go back to my original question about mechanisms. One thing we've looked at in the course of the inquiry is this question of conditionality. Sure. So, for example, people have been asked to sign up to the business pledge. I know members will come on and ask about that in more detail. But there's no advantage to you as a business to sign up in terms of support from the public sector, because businesses are all treated the same. What's the Scottish Government's view on whether, for example, businesses paying the living wage should be treated in a more favourable way by the public sector, get more assistance, or, for example, look at something like, you know, a reduction in business rates for businesses getting the living wage, because that might then assist those who are struggling to pay it, give them that little bit of extra help financially to allow them to cross the threshold. Is that something that's being looked at?
There are conversations about whether or not there are more specific things that can be done through mechanisms such as you've suggested. We wanted to get these things up and running, though, in the first place, and there was an early conversation about conditionality around the business pledge, a decision taken at that point not to impose any conditionality on it. I think they're called robust conversations with the STEC, who were very keen that it should be conditional. At its early outset, we didn't want to do that. We wanted to see how it would run on the purely voluntary basis. There is, you know, you would have to recognise quite a lot of nervousness out there amongst some companies about attaching conditionality to many of these things for obvious reasons. But there are potential mechanisms through which government can explore a reward, if you like, for these things. And I, you know, no final decisions have been made, and I wouldn't want to preempt any decisions that might come to. But it would be wrong to pretend that we weren't having a look at these things and considering whether there are things, for example, through the small business bonus scheme that might be enhanced. I think most small businesses would welcome the small business bonus scheme in its present form, but there may be ways in which it could be enhanced, and there may be other mechanisms through which we could think about these things. So these are conversations that we have all the time, though. And you know, this is a very evolving process.
Okay, John Lamont caught my eye. Is this on the wages issue? Yeah, please.
I was interested in what you said about the small business bonus scheme, because it feels that that would be a very good area to explore conditionality, given that it's particularly small businesses that would suggest there's a pressure on living wage. And so it would be interesting to know at what point you would come to conclusion in that, and there would be a discussion on that. But I want to ask a slightly different question. One of the bits of evidence we got on the living wage and being accredited as a living wage employer was an example of someone who'd moved from minimum wage with one employer to living wage with another, but in fact under terms and conditions which were a great deal worse. That is, there was more pressure at work. He was being expected to do far more, and although he had an increase in his wages, in fact his working life was a great deal more stressful. And I wonder whether, do you have a view on whether in accrediting a living wage employer there is something about looking behind that badge, which is a good badge to have if in fact you've got the badge but the working conditions that people are operating under are
well, really stressful. I think that's actually quite an important aspect of everything here, because it can almost be turned on its head. And I do have conversations with people who say that living wage has become quite iconic, but good work isn't always just about wages. And I think that's, you know, where you're getting to. And I've actually been into visit premises where they're not paying the living wage, but what they've introduced is working conditions which are very good, and staff wouldn't easily want to move elsewhere. So even for individuals, it isn't always about just the wages. Living wage, we want to make totemic, because there isn't any doubt that putting more money in people's pockets does help. But I'm very clear that fair work isn't just about the living wage. And I think, you know, there can be, and I suppose, in, you know, because money is often for people the most important thing, there can be a sense in which the conversation about fair work becomes dominated by the issue of wages, and one ignores the issues that are behind it. To a certain extent, that's what the Scottish Business Pledge was to try and bring on board. A much wider range of things that people would be signing up to. And I do go to employers who, I mean, I haven't come across employers who where they're paying the living wage, but everything else is unfair, if you see what I mean. And I'm not sure quite, you know, I'd be curious to go to some of these companies, because mostly what I go to are companies. Well, I often go to companies where they're maybe not paying the living wage, but there are other things that are going on in that company that are very good, and I can have a conversation with them then about the living wage. I'm not sure I've ever been in a situation where I've seen a company that is doing the living wage part but not doing anything of the others. So I mean, there might be more information that you can...
I think one of the suggestions I think would be useful, or I would ask you what dialogue you have directly with unions, particularly representing workers in these very pressured areas, like retail and care sector particular, because I think there will obviously be lots of case histories of precisely that situation. Now, I'm certainly not advocating that somebody shouldn't be a living wage employer. I am worrying if we give credit to an employer who actually is under-resourcing the workplace, people are doing more work, but they have a living wage, but actually their circumstances are quite difficult. And I would have thought that might be a useful area to explore.
It is. We do have kind of regular conversations. I am, and I don't want to name names of companies because I don't think that would be fair, but I'm conscious that there are some big companies that do pay quite good wages, but I understand that the pressures on workers, you know, for example, at checkouts, are extremely difficult, and the wage alone wouldn't necessarily compensate for some of those pressures. But I think those are things that we would have to just constantly keep under review, constantly be considering. And if there was concrete evidence that there was an issue in and around that, then we would want to take it a good deal further. Have you taken evidence from the Poverty Alliance? I'm not quite sure in terms of the...
The evidence that this came emerged from was from USDA, the Short
right,
Workers
okay.
Union, last week, did indicate that they had only had very limited conversations around the Fair Work Convention and so on. But I do think there is a resource there where people are maybe not able to speak publicly in their workplace, but through their union are given information. I don't know whether it's something that you'd be willing to do some direct contact or meetings with these particular unions who are so centrally involved in these particular sections.
I mean, I'm happy to talk to anybody, and I do. I mean, I have had meetings with a variety of unions as well as directly with the STEC, and of course, the Fair Work Convention, half of the members come from the union side. I will double check to see whether or not the Fair Work Convention is actually discussing some of this, because some of this kind of conversation will be taking place through that mechanism. You know, it is a fair point to make, because it's the difference between an argument about the living wage alone and an argument about fair work in general. And, you know, the living wage does become quite totemic, but the living wage does not in and of itself define the whole of fair work. I think that's an important part of this whole thing.
Okay, Dennis Robertson.
Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. You mentioned the Fair Work Convention in your opening, and you referred to it there just now. And obviously it was set up on the back of Jim Mather's report, Working Together. When we're looking at that framework, and I know that the report is due in March, bringing people together from the different sectors, are they working to the same definition of fair work?
I think you would probably find a great many definitions of fair work. It may very well be that one of the early conversations that the Fair Work Convention had would be to try and develop a definition for themselves. I've seen myself a variety of definitions. Some of them are very kind of bureaucratically defined.
I think that's my question.
Yeah, I don't particularly like any of the definitions I've seen. I tend to say that I could tell you what I think a good job is, but that would be an entirely subjective assessment of it. I would turn it on its head, however, and say that it's actually much more easy to see a bad job when you see it than provide a hard and fast definition of a good job or fair work. Yeah. That most lawyers will tell you when you start to try to precisely define things, the bits that are left out become the big problems. So, yeah.
But in general terms, though, the Fair Work Convention must have a reasonable definition that they're trying to bring
both parties
together.
Yeah, they will be working and developing a sense of how they're seeing it. Yeah. And, you know, I've tried to stay as hands-off as I possibly can on that. I mean, I've occasionally met with the chairs, but I'm not directing their work, and I'm not involved in their meetings. The point about them is that they remain independent, and that when the blueprint is reported to us come March, that it's genuinely not something that I've been instrumental in guiding or drafting.
I think that would compromise it. What the co-chair sent to us, that they're really quite autonomous. And one of the things that they did say as well was that they're trying not to be too prescriptive in some respects. But one of the frustrating things we found, well, certainly I found during our session with the co-chairs, was they kept referring to they were in listening mode. So it was very difficult to tease out any sort of very sort of specifics because they just kept referring to themselves as being in listening mode, and that's fine. However, what I'm wondering is who are they actually listening to, and what is the message coming across? Because one of the things that surprised me when I was looking down the themes, when we're looking at this particular area that we're working at just now within the committee, is that well-being in itself didn't appear as a theme, or I didn't notice it as a theme. And I'm just wondering, do you see that as just an integral part of all the other themes, or should it actually be a specific theme so we can actually try and ensure that well-being of people at work is a separate theme and taken on?
I'm not quite sure what you're asking me there. I mean, well-being, I suppose, you know, you could grow to almost draw in just about everything right across the board of almost every government portfolio. It's you know, is it physical well-being? Is it you know, mental health well-being? Is it you know, what are we actually talking about with well-being?
I think my actual point is the well-being the thread that's going through all the themes to try and ensure that when we're looking at any specifics, whether it be the living wage, that actually ensures a well-being, because in some respects we've just heard that it may not. I'm just wondering, is the well-being a thread that you would see or would hope to see going through all aspects of the themes within the Fair Work Convention?
Well, I mean, to a certain extent, yes, but I mean, it's very difficult to define that. So So the well-being that we're talking about, I mean, I spoke just a few minutes ago about I could give you a subjective definition of what I thought, you know, good work is. And probably that definition wouldn't necessarily have used, my subjective definition wouldn't necessarily have used the word well-being. I'm just slightly uncertain how you can, it's not such a specific term that you can make it a specific thread. It will underlie a great deal of what you're of what's being discussed. I understand that, and there are some very specific references, and I think you've heard some of them in any case from the health side that talk about how important the workplace is to people's mental and physical well-being. Yeah. But if well-being is going to be drawn as something much wider than that, then arguably it is almost presumed in a lot of things that are being talked about without itself becoming a very specific thread. I mean, mm-hmm. well-being, I think in terms of the way government works, it is a interesting cross-portfolio observation to have, and we do have these discussions, but in terms of this kind of thread very specifically, yeah. it would be hard to pin it down.
I know the Deputy First Minister has, you know, always said in terms of things like equality, it goes across all portfolios, and I'm just probably trying to just ascertain as to whether, because we're looking at a report here on the work wages and well-being, and if we're looking at well-being, the other factors is to try and ensure that employees and employers at the end of the day, they have a sense of well-being regardless of where they are. So within that workplace, whether it be the physical aspect or indeed mental, and probably mental health is extremely important. And I'm just wondering, when the convention are meeting and looking at their themes, as to whether or not they've got this aspect when they're in their discussions to try and ensure that in their discussions that well-being is part of that discussion with obviously trade union and with the employers and business to try and ensure that we've got a very healthy workforce going forward, because that in all aspects I would think would increase your productivity and increase, I would think, sustainability and develop the areas that government are actually trying the pathways that government are going down at the moment.
Well, I think I said in an earlier answer, it's hard for me to answer a question which effectively is one for the Fair Work Convention. Yeah. I mean, I genuinely, I'm not sitting in on their meetings. I'm not, you know, specifically trying to direct or help them draft or in any way be part of their considerations. So I would be surprised if the broader definition of well-being was not a consistent part of what they were looking at. But I don't want to be putting words in their mouths when I'm really not in a position to be able to do so. I just, you know, remind everybody that half of the members of that convention are drawn from the trade union side, and I would think that this was would be a very strong part of what they would want to ensure was on the table. Well-being, you know, I guess if you just rephrase it as being somebody feeling, you know, good and comfortable with themselves and having a pretty reasonable state of health and not feeling constantly pressured and stretched and constrained because they haven't got enough money to do things or they're not in a position. You know, that to me, I suppose, is what well-being is. And in that sense, yes, it does underpin pretty much all of the Fair Work portfolio. But that simply because the word well-being isn't used doesn't necessarily mean that it isn't there underpinning everything.
But good is a favourable outcome. Are you confident that the Stage 1 report will be available and ready in March?
The Phase 1 report, the blueprint. Well, yes, that's the timetable they're working to. If it's not ready in March, I'd be worried, but I will go away as a result of the doubt you've now raised in my mind, Mr. Robertson, and absolutely ensure that we can look forward to it. I absolutely genuinely do not ride on the back of the Fair Work Convention. I have set them up and trusted them to do what I've asked them to do in the timescale I've asked them to do it, and I have had no reason to assume that they will not deliver.
That's lovely. Thanks very much, Cabinet Secretary.
Yeah, I wanted to thank, hello, Cabinet Secretary. I wanted to raise the issue that you had touched on earlier of the business pledge and conditionality. And we've taken quite a lot of evidence from, for example, Scottish Enterprise, who confirmed that there wasn't any conditionality in terms of the business pledge. Obviously, in the pledge itself, there is one element in the conditionality, and that you don't get to sign the pledge unless you pay the living wage. But I was interested in what you said about the conversations you had at an early stage about the business pledge. You kind of gave a hint that it was a kind of work in progress and that you were keeping a watching brief on it. Is that the case?
The pledge doesn't sit directly within my portfolio. I should say it sits across both my portfolio and the Deputy First Minister's portfolio.
Right.
There were early conversations about it because the STEC raised the issue of conditionality. So we had a conversation directly with the STEC about it. The decision was made early on that conditionality wouldn't attach to it. Although I think I'm right in saying there's actually two things on the business pledge that need to be ticked definitely, and that's the living wage and not using the exploitative 0 hours contracts. The others, people have to sign up to working towards. They've got to basically agree that they're signing up to it as a work in progress. But there are aspects all through the business pledge that that some businesses have flagged up to us that maybe give us a bit of an issue. I don't know whether or not Joe wants to come in, but my recollection is, for example, the internationalisation one. There are some companies which, by the nature of what they do, they are barred from going cross border. I think things like credit unions and things like that. So there are one or two where, by definition of who and what they do, can't tick or can't say that they are working towards, you know, some of these pledges. So in that sense, yes, it has to be a bit of a work in progress. We have to continually make sure that the business pledge does work in terms of maximising the likely sign up. But at the moment, it is what it is. These are the kinds of things that you would constantly keep under review, though. I don't think there's anything that you would just set so far in stone that you wouldn't want to continually be looking at it. Joe, I don't know if you want to say something about the business pledge.
Yeah, I mean, the concept really is to engage the business in a relationship and in a dialogue. So if, by coming forward, saying that they pay the living wage and signing the business pledge and two others from the criteria that are available, there's then a discussion that ensues, and it may be that government agencies or indeed others with expertise that are able to come forward and help them to work towards another aspect of the pledge. So, for example, the Institute of Directors have been very proactive and very visible on 50-50 aims in boardrooms, and by knowing a company signed the pledge, they would like to move towards 50-50, they're finding it difficult, we can actually signpost them towards the Institute of Directors for a deeper dialogue on that particular aspect. But the idea is to engage that relationship so that there's then talk about all the aspects of the pledge, rather than just the ones at entry point.
I think the 0 hours contracts is one of the a range that you could select from. The living wage is conditional, but the 0 hours contract is one of a range, and I understand that the minister's saying that the business pledge doesn't fall into her remit. So I think the 0 hours contract is something that you can choose. It's not mandatory. But just to go on in terms of the pledge, in terms of building up a dialogue with business, if there isn't any conditionality in the sense of like Scottish Enterprise grants and so on, what's in it for business? Signing the pledge, you know, what is the carrot, if you like?
Well, you know, that goes back to the kind of conditionality thing. We're not at the moment giving rewards for it. The reward is the recognition that this is a business which is genuinely committed to a range of actions which are going to mark that business out as being one where you could expect there to be a very good working environment. Those businesses that sign up to the business pledge will often say to you that they don't understand why others don't, because it makes they just think it basically speaks for itself. Why would you not want to? But at this stage, it's the other side of the conditionality argument. At this stage, there are neither carrots nor sticks unless you take on board, you know, the support and help that businesses that are signed up to the pledge might get in their exploration of other aspects of it to get them to begin to start ticking off some of the other things. You know, this area is at the moment about using as much of the soft power of government as you possibly can. It's about encouraging, it's about generating debate and a conversation. I've used the words living wage community because I begin to see and sense that way in which those companies which are stepping up to accredit, to sign on to the business pledge, begin to see themselves as part of something better. And it is quite subjective in that sense. Without more powers, it's hard to attach a lot of conditionality to a lot of this kind of thing. So we do what we can within the powers that we have available. Explorations of conditionality may continue to be part of the conversation. But at this point, we are effectively testing the water to see how widespread the take-up is likely to be.
Right, okay. One of the things that the people can sign up to, which you've alluded to, is the balanced workforce. At the Business and Parliament conference at the weekend, there was a number of women that raised the issue of how you monitor that, because one of the things that's come out in this committee inquiry is the quality of data generally. So in terms of outcomes for the economy as a whole, if we are putting a big emphasis on balanced workforce and gender, if gender's not, if it's not monitored as part of, you know, the government's outcomes, how do you know how successful the policy's been? I mean, I realise this may be one for your officials, but it's just, it was raised by a couple of people at the conference. They were very pleased with what the government was doing, but they would wondered if the mechanism was there to deflect outcomes.
I'm conscious that there is just an issue about what the stats tell us, how much we can mine from the stats. And yes, I will bring James in shortly. I just wanted to kind of, this is what effectively we get each month. This is the labour market stats, and that's effectively a very broad brush set of stats that give you the headline results for the whole of the UK in terms of employment, unemployment, inactivity, and for Scotland. But this is all done through the ONS. This is not done by us specifically. This has come from the much bigger survey that the ONS do every month. On the reverse side, you get the youth rates and levels, the female rates and levels, and some of the main labour market outcomes. So basically, it's quite broad brush. So it could tell us, for example, that we know from tracking this every month, over the last year, the increases in the employment levels in Scotland tended to be driven by increased numbers of women in the workforce. Going into almost like a company by company, sector by sector look at that is a much harder business. For Scotland, this basically surveys about 5,000 households, and the difficulty with it is that you only have to have quite small shifts for it to then reflect quite, you know, significantly in terms of the figures, which tends to, you know, explain some of the fluctuations up and down. And is it a level of frustration? Well, I'll bring James in and he can tell you how our conversations tend to go when we are demanding to know much more information and detail about localised geographical areas and things like that you're talking about, and his frustration in trying to explain to us that what we're asking for at the moment is not really statistically easily replied. James, do you want to get geeky?
Yes. Of course, I mean, there's been much discussion about credible Scottish labour market data. One of the key things I would flag up is there's currently a review of the national indicator set for the Scottish Government's national performance framework. There's a working group being chaired by the Chief Statistician, and there's a number of bodies feeding into that, including STUC and Oxfam Scotland. One of the key areas they've identified for improvement is around work and employment, specifically job security, job fulfilment and job satisfaction. They're looking at a whole host of indicators just now, and one of the indicators they are considering from official statistics is, you know, women-led business gender equal boards. That review is due to publish in early 2016, and there's going to be another meeting of stakeholders, including STUC, in November. So, you know, that's something that's actively being considered just now. As for the broader point about labour market statistics, yeah, the labour market statistics are gathered by ONS. There is variability, but the Scottish Government pays a significant sum of money every year to boost the samples in the labour force survey to get kind of disaggregated data. The labour force survey isn't the only source of information in the labour market, so I think the idea of not having credible data is, you know, it's too broad brushed a statement. There are various sources of labour market data from the Labour Force Survey, from the UK Commission for Employment and Skills, and from the WERS Survey. So it's about looking at all these sources together and saying, well, what's the overall narrative? There's no one single source that gives you the answer in terms of the data.
Whereas obviously the STUC have been critical of the labour market data in Scotland, and is it an issue of powers or is it an issue of resources? Is it that we have to accept the figures that the ONS give us, or is it, could we build our own but that would cost more? What's the problem really?
Yeah, I mean, on the STUC's point, ONS conducted a review of the Labour Force Survey in 2014. And the STUC were looking for monthly estimates rather than the kind of quarterly data that we get just now. And the ONS concluded that without a significant input of funding, it's just not possible to do that. So the issue is around resources and cost.
Right. Okay. Thank you very much.
I mean, we basically have two. We have this one that's monthly, and then we fund a bigger boost for the annual population survey to make sure that there's strong enough data from Scotland in the annual population survey to give us something that's of use. The difficulty is not just these measurements, but what it measures, because I have to say, when I first started doing this job and first had the conversations, I was slightly concerned to find out, you know, that even 1 or 2 hours a week working registers you on this as working. Now, you know, so you're looking at a measure which is quite, I think, quite a crude measure, because I'm not sure all of us would think that 1 or 2 hours a week in work would register, but it does. Mm-hmm. So, and that's why I'm just sort of, you know, in and around all of these figures, there are quite, you know, substantial underpinning issues that I suspect only very large amounts of money might yeah. figure
out. It's also an issue like the Scottish Government's priorities and where we are going in Scotland is in a different direction from what the ONS is recording, and you don't really have the powers to kind of direct it, to measure what you
well,
want.
Well, we don't have the powers to direct ONS, clearly. We pay more money to get a better annual survey for Scotland's purposes. These figures are extracted for Scotland from the ONS figures that they would just do every month. And yes, it does mean that you have to just regard these figures with a little bit of caution, because they don't give us some of the granularity at that stage that you might be looking for. You know, and there are, you know, James is right, there are other issues. I mean, claimant count, for example, is another measure that you might want to go and look at to see what's happening. And that might give you some better ideas, because the problem for me is this treats Scotland as if it's a single region, a single unit, when we know that the variety of labour markets across Scotland is quite vast. You know, you can't say that the labour market in Shetland or the northeast of Scotland is going to be the same as the labour market in Fife or Ayrshire. So, and that's the difficulty that we grapple with, trying to establish to our satisfaction that those regional labour markets within Scotland are as understood as well as they can be. And we're trying to do some work in government on a labour market strategy that would work for Scotland. We're not finished that piece of work yet.
Thanks very much.
Okay, thanks. Now, on the topic of the business pledge and zero hours contracts, I've got three members who want to come in with follow-ups. So Gordon MacDonald, Liz MacDonald and Patrick Harvey. So I'll start with you.
Okay, thanks very much, Gordon. Convener. You mentioned that the business pledge is about paying a living wage and working towards other aspects of it. And one of the other aspects or elements that's been listed is investing in youth. And that's quite a wide statement. What does that actually mean? Is it just about providing work experience, or is it about providing employment or modern apprenticeships? What does investing in youth actually relate to in terms of the business pledge?
Well, it would relate to a whole range of things, and that would include work experience, but all the way up to providing modern apprenticeships. You would be looking at what a company was doing to bring on young people. Are they recruiting young people? Are they treating those young people fairly? Everything, you know, the investing in youth part would cover all of those. It's not prescriptive as to numbers of MAs, for example. It's not prescriptive to any one part of it. So it would cover that whole range of things from providing work experience opportunities, providing paid internships might you know be part of that, actively recruiting young people, looking at you know whether or not they're doing modern apprenticeships. Of course, there are other ways to do the training and skills. Not all companies that do apprenticeships are buying into the modern apprenticeship model. So we're not being prescriptive about how they do it, as long as they are doing it across the board.
Right. And when Professor Chris Warhurst was here on the 30th of September, he spoke about a high road and a low road in relation to job quality. And by high road, he meant firms moving into high value-added innovative product markets, which would raise the pay and skill levels of employees. You know, what is the Scottish Government doing in order to provide that high-skilled workforce in order that we can achieve the high-road economy that Professor Warhurst was referring to?
Well, you know, a lot of that is directed through the modern apprenticeship system and the work we're trying to do to shift the balance much more in favour of the STEM subjects, where some of the biggest skills gaps currently are. So is one part of what we're doing. The careers, the reformed careers advice in schools will be pushing towards that as well, to try and encourage as many young people as possible to choose careers that will have the capacity to give them effectively lifelong well-paid work instead of falling into areas out of almost like a default. We make sure that young people have as much information as they can possibly have. Supporting and trying to work with some industry sectors where they are flagging up skills gaps. We are conscious of there being skills gaps in some areas. Not every intervention needs necessarily be a purely government intervention. I think there has to be a challenge to employers and to training boards and industry itself that they have to think more long-term about what they're doing. And we are constantly in dialogue with employers themselves and training providers about how they can best move this. You know, we didn't get to where we are overnight, so we're not going to change it overnight either. What we are trying to do is indeed to move Scotland towards that highly skilled and, by definition, higher paid economy. But that can't be done. That's not something you can do without also looking at those who are on the bottom end of the system and trying to improve things for them as well. So I guess you're trying to do both together in order to achieve the outcome that you're looking for.
In order to move to that high road economy, we need good standard of modern apprenticeships. Mm. And there was a recent Ofsted report that covered apprenticeships in England and Wales. And a couple of their key findings was that the quality of apprenticeship provision reviewed during this survey was too variable and often poor, and the growth in apprenticeships in the last 8 years has not focused sufficiently on the sectors with skill shortages. I mean, you know, and I realise this is a report relating to England and Wales, but what assurances can you give that that isn't being replicated here?
Well, I think our apprenticeship system is quite different to the one that's been in place down south, and I'm not an expert in the system that is in operation down south, so I wouldn't want to be drawn too far into a discussion of it or indeed criticism of it. I am aware of the Ofsted report. I did see it. It came across my desk. What we're trying to do in Scotland is move the apprenticeship system in a very different direction. I mean, our apprenticeships are actual jobs. They're not basically attaching the label apprenticeship to something that isn't an actual job, which I think was one of the criticisms that Ofsted had, that these apprenticeships weren't truly jobs, whereas what we're doing is you know, the apprenticeship is the job. I think that's an important driver in Scotland. It means we're investing in quality, and although, you know, we want to increase the numbers as well, I don't want to just be talking about an increase in numbers without a consideration of quality at the same time. And I would be a little sceptical that some of the numbers I've seen suggested for England and Wales would deliver the quality that we would expect to see. I mean, we're looking at apprenticeships which range from foundation apprenticeships, where people are still spending part of their time in school and part of their time in college and beginning to look at that level, but we're also talking right the way through to graduate apprenticeships. So, you know, our system is quite different.
And the last point I wanted to ask was, going back to Professor Warhurst's evidence on the 30th of September, you've mentioned a couple of times that we have to invest in quality. And I know procurement doesn't fall within your remit, but what he suggested was, and I'm just interested in your view, he said one small thing that we could do is to attach public procurement contract to our public procurement contracts a clause that requires a company that wins a contract to report on their job quality. And I'm just wondering what you felt about that.
I don't think it's unreasonable. I'm not sure if it's in the new guidance, a kind of report back, but what the new guidance that's only just been published is basically indicating that effectively fair work is something that should be looked at objectively by those who are doing the contracting. So I guess that probably would cover, because unless you get some indication of what's going on in companies, you couldn't possibly know what the precise mechanism that would then entail. I can certainly establish and get back to you, or ask Keith Brown to do so directly, if that would help.
Okay, thanks very much.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. You said a few minutes ago in response to a question that there were two requirements on a company which wanted to sign the Scottish Business Pledge. First, that they would have to pay the living wage, and second, that they should not use exploitative zero-hours contracts. Now, looking at the published version of the pledge and the requirements upon it, zero-hours contracts does not appear in the published version to be a requirement. Can you clarify what the position is and what you meant by your remarks?
I thought it was, but this may be a function of the fact that it's not emanating from my portfolio. Joe, do you? I thought that not using exploitative zero-hours contracts was one of two things that we were asking people to sign up to.
The mandatory thing is that companies pay the living wage and that they enter into a commitment to work towards all other nine aspects, and that they pursue. They have already delivered on two of the nine. Sorry, that's not very clear. They must pay the living wage. They must do two other aspects of the nine criteria, and they must sign a commitment to work towards all of them.
So the position is then that a company which does use exploitative zero-hours contracts can still cheerfully sign the Scottish Business Pledge as long as it makes an unspecified commitment to work towards removing or ceasing to use exploitative zero-hours contracts at some unspecified point in the future.
Well, I think that expressing it in that way is probably unfair on the companies that are signing up to the business pledge, because they are committing themselves very strongly to a broad range of fair work practices. And I doubt in those circumstances whether you could characterise somebody as signing up cheerfully to the business pledge when they're not doing a whole lot of the other things that we were asking them to do. I think that would be an unfair characterisation of those companies that have signed up to the business pledge. I mean, I have to say, if there is evidence, if you have evidence that, you know, there are companies that are doing that, then I would be interested to know that, and to, you know, and I would certainly flag it up to officials, but I'm not aware of it.
I did wonder if the reason you mentioned it as a condition when it's not formally such, whether the reason for that might be that you think personally that it should have been a condition.
Well, you know, we can all think that perhaps every single one of these things could be a condition, but we're not in a position to be able to demand that every single hoop be jumped through right at the start. What we're trying to do is to just encourage companies to sign up to this, and they themselves then are undertaking to begin to go through those hoops themselves if they're not already there. And I think I've already indicated that there are some companies for whom some of the hoops may be things that they are precluded from doing within the context of the particular sector that they're in, and that's a conversation that needs to be had as well. Now, that doesn't apply to 0 hours contracts. Personally, I would not wish to see any company using 0 hours contracts in a way which is exploiting workers, and there are different ways which they can be used to exploit workers. But equally, and this is, I mean, I know this is a definition that has bedeviled for many years, but equally there are rare occasions, or some occasions, in which a 0 hours contract does work for people. And that's why nobody says ban 0 hours contracts outright, because there are occasions when it does work for people.
You said earlier that after robust conversations with the STC, it was decided to attach no conditionality to the business pledge other than the one reference. Was that a decision taken by your department, by the business department? Where did that decision come
from? That wasn't a conversation that I was initially involved in. I am aware of the difference of opinion because of the Scottish Government STC meetings that have taken place. You know, you'll appreciate that there are, over a range of portfolios, a lot of conversations in and around this area. I understand the problems that might have emanated from attaching too much conditionality to something like the business pledge. Equally, it has been something over a range of different policy issues that this government has tried to pursue things initially on a voluntary basis. You know, although it's got no relevance to this, the plastic bag, carry bag initiative and all the rest of it, we tried to do what we could on a voluntary basis before resorting to anything that did involve, you know, kind of reward / risk for companies. So, you know, I think what we're trying to do is to shift the debate and get business into a place where they are part of something that's better than where we are just now. But, you know, conditionality is a big issue.
It is, Cabinet Secretary, and would it be reasonable to conclude from what you said, and that you were not involved in those discussions, that decision would have been made by Cabinet on the recommendation of Mr. Swinney?
I couldn't tell you precisely how that was done. I mean, I think that the business pledge came to Cabinet, but those decisions would have been entered into at a different level.
But not in the Fair Work.
Well, no, it doesn't. The business pledge didn't emanate from my portfolio, but that doesn't mean to say that I don't have an active involvement in doing it, pursuing it. It's the same as, I guess, it's like procurement. It doesn't emanate from my portfolio, but it doesn't mean to say that I haven't also got an interest in it. It's one of the hallmarks of this particular portfolio that it is very leaky around the edges. and those are not the only two other portfolios where there is a bit of an overlap, social justice as well, education as well. So there's a big broad area around the edge of this portfolio that does impact on other portfolios, or other portfolios impact on us.
Understood. But to focus on 0 hours contracts, and as you say, there, it's important to distinguish and to recognise when a 0 hours contract is an exploitative one. And I think, as Mr. Griffin has described the terms of the business pledge, it is that it's working towards removal of exploitative 0 hours contracts from any existing practice. One of the difficulties we've had as a committee is getting any public body to define when a 0 hours contract becomes exploitative, and I wonder if you can help us in any way with that.
I have come across examples, and I suppose what happens here is, again, it's often easier to see when it is exploitative rather than to make a definition that describes it. But, for example, I have come across a situation where people who are on 0 hours contracts come in to work, spend money travelling to work, to arrive at work, to be told there is no work, and they need to come back in 4 hours or 6 hours or tomorrow. So they're spending scarce resources on transport to and from a workplace that doesn't. And I think that's an absolutely obvious example of exploitative use of 0 hours contracts. Equally, I know companies where, you know, they would make a very robust defence of a use of 0 hours contract because they only need occasional labour for very specific days. And they want to be able to go back to the same individuals because that gives them the comfort of knowing that people are experienced. But that wouldn't be exploitative because it suits both sides in those circumstances. So a definition, I think, would have to centre around the use of 0 hours contracts in a way where all the detriment applied to the employee and not to the employer.
But just for clarity, what, very briefly, well, if I may
point out, yeah, if it would help, that the First Minister has given us a definition of exploitative.
Oh, I think this is to the
an issue I raised at the conveners group,
yeah,
a few weeks ago, and subsequent to that, the First Minister wrote to me, and we shared this with the committee with a definition. So there is one out there.
Deny workers regular or insufficient working hours or unfairly penalise workers for being unavailable for work or not accepting offers of work. Yeah, I mean, I mean, I think that's fair enough. I guess I would, you know, you would have to endorse that because clearly that is a definition, although I'm not sure which one the situation that I described would fall into in those circumstances.
I think there's a couple of points with reference to the First Minister's letter. I mean, I think it's important to put on record the First Minister's letter says the same thing that the Cabinet Secretary said.
In different words.
Well, it says explicitly all businesses who sign up to the Scottish Business Pledge must confirm that they do not employ people on exploitative 0 hours or very low hours contracts. Now, that is what the Cabinet Secretary said, so... I think there is a clear need for some clarification.
Yeah, can we take that? Can we take that back and double check that?
That would be very helpful.
Yes, the First Minister and I are at one on our understanding, so perhaps we better check with the DFM as to whether or not we're at one with the DFM.
Yeah, you may be both wrong. Yes,
if we're both wrong, then I'm in good company.
But from the point of view of a business which wishes to sign this pledge, first of all, there's a clear need to be clear about that.
Sure.
But also, if a business comes to the government to seek advice as to what is an exploitative 0 hours contract, the First Minister's definition in this letter continues to include words which are relative. Mm. So, for example, insufficient working hours or unfairly penalising workers. None of that appears to me to be a definition that a company can rely on to demonstrate that it has or has not met the criteria.
This is back to me being a lawyer again, which is just that, you know, there are, I'm afraid, situations that you will never be able to precisely define to encompass every single potential occasion when something might be described in that way, which is why in both legislation and in the law, you will frequently find the word reasonable used, because while it's, you know, it's a fairly well settled understanding. And I think that most reasonable employers are going to know what is reasonable in terms of 0 hours contracts. And, you know, they are a tool. They did come out of, oddly enough, a kind of professional employment when professional people wanted to work on a very flexible and fluid basis. And, of course, at that point, arguably all the balance of power was in the hands of the professional who wanted to work that way, that the problem has arisen because they've become to be used so widespread. And in some places of employment, the balance of power has gone completely the other way. And I guess, you know, that's really where you find that bit right in the middle that ensures that you're not in a situation where an individual is forced into this and has no ability to maximise their use of it, and it's all on the employer's side to do so. But definitions of some of this, I don't think you will ever be in a position to be able to absolutely define it, and I think you will look in vain for any use of the phrase exploitative zero-hours contracts is generally not then followed up with a very precise definition. That, you know, the definition the First Minister has given is useful, but, you know, she too is a lawyer, and we would always know that you will always find things that fall outside definitions, and that is the danger of defining too closely.
Useful but not definitive.
Well, but in this area, there probably is no way to be utterly definitive about any aspect of it, and I think that's a bigger conversation. And I appreciate that the committee can't go there, but I think that is a reality often that where we have to operate in these areas of policy.
Okay, Patrick Harvey.
Thank you. Good morning. I think it might be fair just to say that we're all, even the First Minister, working toward a shared understanding of where we can go with these issues, and it's not a useless conversation simply because we're not 100% definitive. I wanted to explore a little bit more broadly this agenda of conditionality, and in reference to the evidence from Professor Warhurst, which I think Gordon MacDonald referred to earlier, this image of the high road and the low road. It's come out quite frequently during the inquiry, and it's not just a question of this being a choice between do we want to be on the high road or do we want to be on the low road. I don't think anyone has criticised the idea that encouragement, whether in terms of celebrating the living wage community, whether in terms of developing the skills agenda, that encouragement, that paving the high road approach has got a great deal of value in relation to some employers who are keen, open-minded, or who just need a bit of support to get there. But I think Professor Warhurst was also very clearly saying that there are also employers out there who quite openly and directly are competing on low-cost labour, are quite happy to continue very exploitative practices because they find it profitable, they find it attractive, they have no intention of changing, so you need to block the low road. It's not just about encouragement. So I put this to the First Minister last week in the Chamber, that we need to place as much emphasis on job quality as on job numbers in a range of government-funded business support services through the enterprise agencies and grant schemes. I'll give you one example. The application form for the Regional Selective Assistance Grants has one question about youth employment, but obviously it's talking about young people up to the age of 25, so they won't all be getting the higher age bands of the minimum wage, and there's nothing about employers going above that basic minimum legal requirement. There's nothing about pay ratios, about secure hours, about union recognition, worker participation, the use of tax havens, gender and age equality. So I suggested to the First Minister that we should be placing a wider emphasis on job quality, on those wide range of support services and grant schemes. She said that was a fair argument to make, and I hope that the Cabinet Secretary is of one mind with the First Minister on this as well.
I mean, one could argue that the creation of this portfolio is, in a sense, one answer to that, because job quality is what this is about. Many of the things we do are around that. There are, however, issues that would need to be explored about some wider aspects of conditionality. And you only have to listen to the debate around what is and is not possible through the procurement system to understand that it isn't as straightforward as it might first appear. So those are things that we would want to look at. My I would agree with the First Minister that these are all the kinds of things that you're talking about are all things we should be exploring, are part and parcel of what this portfolio will be doing. It's only been in existence now for slightly less than a year, so we've done a great deal. Have we done absolutely everything that we could be doing? Well, obviously not, and we are going to continue to do that. And I'm looking forward to getting the Fair Work Convention blueprint in March, because I suspect that may deal with some of these issues as well. And, you know, we are also right now, you know, going through a process of thinking forward as to what else we need to do. And you know, we are going to have to give some thought to some of these other parts of the equation. Having started out with the encouragement, are there other things that we can do to make it slightly more directed?
I recognise that, and I welcome the acknowledgement that there's always more that can be done. I'm not about to sit here and accuse the government of doing nothing. So is the government actively exploring at present the option of how much conditionality can be attached to government support services and grant schemes? And underlying that, is there a principled intention to block the low road?
Well, blocking the low road, as far as I understand it, wouldn't be entirely within our
to whatever extent.
I mean, I think there is. We are looking at what might be possible in certain areas, whether or not. I'm not going to be drawn at this stage, because there is a process of decision making within government, which I'm not going to preempt. What I'm telling you is these are considerations that we keep under review and are part of conversations which we do have. And there will be an active look. I mean, I use the words job quality constantly, because just looking at the numbers doesn't give you enough confidence that the job quality is there. And I talked about how 1 or 2 hours work a week can have that's registered as somebody in employment. Well, you know, you have to look behind these numbers. Absolutely. But looking behind these numbers does then throw up a whole set of considerations that you'd need to take into account, not least of which whether you are legally able to do some of the things that you might choose to do or might want to do.
I recognise that, and I think all of us would welcome the fact that the Scottish Government places emphasis on job quality and takes this issue seriously. At the same time, we're still providing support services and opening the door to applications for grant schemes to businesses that aren't listening to that language. Is it the intention of the Government, within whatever scope is legally possible, to find ways of blocking the low road, of closing down those forms of support to companies that wish to continue exploitative and low-wage practices?
These are conversations that we have within government all the time, and when there are specific proposals, we will bring them forward.
Thank you.
Maybe I could just ask a follow-up question to Mr. Harvey's question. Because one example that's been kicked around the committee in the course of this inquiry is that of Amazon, who were supported by, I think, £10 million worth of grants in public funds, regional selective assistance and other funds that came when they came to Scotland. And our company, I think it's fair to say, that has been in the spotlight, shall we say, in terms of employment practices. If Amazon came today with a proposal for another plant in Scotland, would the Scottish Government's view be different to what it was historically?
Well, they wouldn't come to me. It wouldn't be me that would make that decision.
The Scottish Government would.
I can't answer that. I mean, I'm not in a position to be able to answer that. There would be, I would imagine, a fairly robust internal discussion about that.
Okay, briefly, Joanna.
It would be the case, though, that in the Cabinet, whoever in the Cabinet is responsible for that would be obliged to consult with your department on your view about whether it is within the principled view of fair work, given the commitment, and I recognise that you're actually establishing that post. Would it not be extraordinary if they made that decision without referring to your department and to you, but your views about
I suspect how that money was being used? More than just myself would be involved in that conversation. It wouldn't just be me.
But it would at least be you.
I would expect so.
Okay, check one.
Thank you. Good morning. I wonder if I can just move discussion on a bit. One of the phrases that will be aligned with this committee is the good, the bad, and the ugly. It doesn't refer to the report, hopefully, but we did talk about management and the training of management. Now, clearly, managers play a big role in work and the well-being and the job qualities. I wonder if you can tell us, Cabinet Secretary, what the government can do to ensure that there's more management training provision. This was an issue that was raised during the visit to Paisley. The issue was raised yesterday in the Education Committee with SDS, and I think we generally feel there might be a challenge in front of us. So I wonder if you can enlighten us as to what the government plans to do in terms of management training, particularly for SMEs.
Well, I suppose the first response I would have to that is that, you know, while I suppose I come from the direction that says government should have a wide-ranging role in many aspects of employment, I don't absolutely buy into the argument that it should thereby displace all responsibility for these things to industry itself. And you know, one of the interesting things about the Wood Commission, and this is not a diversion from the response, was his on the young workforce, was his concern that employers themselves hadn't really been stepping up to the plate on youth workers. And I would say that if there is a concern amongst SMEs about the quality of the management that they have, I would expect to hear from SMEs some indication of what they thought could be done and achieved. I have not had any representations made to me, and I'm not conscious of any being made to, it would probably go directly to Fergus Ewing, that would be requests for government to be involved in more specific management training than is currently conducted through the normal processes where managers become trained. Now, I appreciate in SMEs, managers tend to evolve rather than necessarily become trained. But I wonder the extent to which government can be expected to step into that particular breach. I'm not conscious of what the specifics of the evidence were that you got in Paisley, but you know, I would want to have a conversation with businesses themselves about what they're doing in terms of management training. I mean, there is a finite limit, I think, to what government can be expected to do in some of these areas.
I think that's a fair answer, but again, one of the issues raised yesterday and again at the breakfast meeting with Donald McRae of the Bank of Scotland, when we were talking about part of the government's strategy is increasing internationalism, you know, our hopes for exports and internationalisation. We've discussed internationalisation here, and I agree that the government can't do everything, but the question is whether or not that discussion that you just mentioned with SMEs, and indeed discussions with other companies regarding the need to support the government strategy is of a high enough profile that it is actually taking effect.
Well, I mean, there's a range of advice and support on offer, you know, through SDI, through Scottish Enterprise, through a lot of these organisations that companies can make an initial approach to, and I would always encourage companies to do so. And I think you heard about the business pledge that one of the benefits that there might be for those companies that are wanting to improve aspects of their own business practices will get help and directed to those areas where they where that will be most forthcoming. I mean, there are areas in which government has been specifically involved in setting up. I'm not talking about management advice now at the moment or specific management practices. But you know, there are in existence already some mechanisms for which advice can be got. There is perhaps a question mark over how, particularly with the smaller end of SMEs, how aware they are of what might be out there, what might be available. You know, on a range of issues, SMEs can present a challenge simply because we are talking in some cases about businesses with very small numbers of people. So trying to get, for example, modern apprentices out into very small businesses, that takes a good deal of support. But the SDS, for example, is there to support them if that's something they want to go down. They will have a, they can go have a conversation with SDS about that. I suppose it might, this might boil down to how much very small businesses understand about what is already available and whether or not there is a view out of business that there needs to be something separately set up. I've not had that expressed to me either by FSB or the Chambers of Commerce or the CBI. So I think it's something that we would have to look at more carefully.
I think that would be helpful because as part of the business pledge, of course, there is one of the items is pursuing international business opportunities. But I wonder if I can then go on to the Mather review. And the Scottish Government reiterated its belief that, and I quote, trade unions are key social and economic partners and play an important role in sustaining effective democracy in society. That's true, in terms of particularly in the sectoral, their approach to various business sectors. I just wonder, though, in terms of democracy in the workplace, have there been any discussions or do you have any plans for discussions to talk about equity participation in the workplace, decision-making, sharing in the workplace, like where you work councils in Germany? Has there been any conversation along those lines to align it with well-being and job quality in the workplace?
Well, yes, of course, because that's part and parcel, I guess, of what we're doing in terms of this portfolio. So, you know, I frequently have meetings with the STEC, these are aspects of what we talk about. The discussions that are going around the trade union bill at the moment are part of that. And yes, you know, I think we would want to try and move us towards a model where both employees and employers felt that they were equal partners in this. But we're dealing with a business culture which is pretty strongly embedded and will not be turned around overnight. Yeah. And the benefits of it have got to be short. And the point about things like living wage accreditation, the business pledge, and the other things that we're doing is about getting those businesses who, you know, if you like, the light bulb has switched on, is what's important to that. I don't deny that there are other businesses out there for whom this is of peripheral interest. We've tended not to want to point the finger at the bad businesses, but at the moment try to pull up businesses by the use of exemplars, which is effectively what the schemes currently are about.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, I'll take a brief supplementary, please, from Lewis McDonald.
Yeah, just on this issue of, I think there's been plenty of evidence of the benefits of trade union membership for people, particularly in low pay and insecure work. The trade union bill is coming down the track. It is likely to be passed by the House of Commons. What steps will the Scottish Government take to mitigate against the impacts of that, particularly on those in insecure or low-paid work?
Take every step that is possible to ensure that the good industrial relations record that we have achieved in Scotland is maintained. And we are actively looking at and exploring every aspect of what that might be.
And that would include, for example, issues around check-off and pay time off for work in your own
employees. It will include absolutely everything.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Richard Lyon.
Yes, thank you, Convener. Actually, two of the questions I was going to ask both members I've asked them, but I would like to explore further the point that Lewis McDonald was going on. We have a company which is paying a living wage, and we know this company who came out now and said, you know, we're the first grocery company to pay the living wage, but they don't really, they aren't encouraging people to join a trade union within the firm. In the 60s, I remember the 60s, Harold Wilson used to say that he brought the unions in for beer and sandwiches. In the 80s and 90s, the Tories actively discouraged trade unionism. What steps, I heard you saying, Cabinet Secretary, that you're encouraging in discussion with the STUC, but what further discussions are you having with trade unions on the whole in order to ensure that we are having a good working relationship, or you are having a good working relationship with trade unions in order to promote the living wage, promote good working conditions, and also encourage other companies to have discussions with the STUC and the other trade unions in order to ensure that they're given a good work?
These conversations are being had all the time, and you know, both formally and informally, they are part and parcel of what we do. The Fair Work Convention. I don't want to sound constantly repetitive, but the Fair Work Convention, the membership is made up, half from the trade union side, which is I think was an important pointer to how we wanted these things to proceed. It's my personal view, as well as my government view, that the better the relationship between trade unions and employers, the better for everybody in the long run. And it makes sense for employers to be talking to trade unions. I've spoken to employers. It's much easier for employers to deal with situations in their business if they have active trade unions. I regret some of the things in the trade union bill, because I think they will have a negative impact on those good workings, which we encourage all employers to be part of. My dialogue with trade unions, however, has got to be matched with the dialogue that trade unions have to have with businesses too. Again, that goes back to why the Fair Work Convention is important. We can't emphasise the dialogue that is between government and trade unions and think that somehow this third key part of the equation isn't equally as important. And that is part and parcel of what this is all about as well.
Okay, thank you. Okay, well, I think that neatly takes us to the end of our time. Oh. Cabinet Secretary, thank you to you and your officials for coming along. And we now have the job of producing a report, which
I look forward to seeing
should
you.
Be available.
These are always helpful because, we understand that definitions are difficult. We understand that there is a kind of wide-ranging reach for all of these aspects. So look forward to your report.
Okay. So thank you all very much. At this point, we will suspend briefly and go into private session.